on she goes. That back track really got away with me there. That's 3 whole minutes of jam. That's unbelievable. Hi guys, how you doing? It's Monday. We're doing the thing that we do on Mondays, which is hang out and talk about the guitar. Specifically, we're talking about what happens when fingers from this hand make their way into the territory usually occupied by fingers from this hand. Yes, folks, by popular request, we're talking about tapping today. I want to thank you for your patience with that prolonged intro jam. Didn't realize how long I was going there. I was having far too much fun playing all the tapping stuff. But hey, listen, it's great to be here. It's nice to be back in my little studio. It's good to have you guys on board. Let's talk a little bit about what we're doing today. So today, we are discussing how you, dear friend, can get some of this tapping goodness into your playing, regardless of, irrespective of, your personal style, your personal technique level. So this is appropriate for players of all standards, players who have the shred thing down pat, but also players who are more melodic players, players who are more chordal players, folks who are just dipping their toe or dipping their finger into the tapping thing. This is going to be for you, but if you are one of our shred contingent, like Sacred Godslayer, who's in the house, for example, we're going to have some cool stuff for you guys too. Want to take a quick second and shout out today's sponsor as well, though. Today's stream is sponsored by the String Sling. Now, you might have seen a review of this fun little strap slash guitar protector that is currently adorning the Maybach Convair over here. We're going to get the red PRS back out in a second because there's a lot of love for the red PRS at the moment. But let me show you what's going on here. This is today's sponsor, not the guitar, but this big red guy on here. This is the String Sling. So what it does is, long story long, it is a big kind of microfiber cloth that protects your sling, these strings rather, in transit, buffs the strings, buffs the guitar. But here's the fun thing, right? It also doubles up as a guitar strap. So you take this off, throw it over your shoulder, and I'm gonna see if I can mess this up. I've got a lot of hair going on here, which is never fun when you put straps on, but check it out, right? Here we go. Look at this, right? It's got a strap. It's got a little buffer, and it works really, really well. It's a fun addition to your arsenal of guitar accessories. It's going to keep your strings nice, keep your guitar protected in transit, and it also doubles as a strap. Now, you might be wondering, but I have a strap. Well, let me tell you, right? I have a strap, and I have a strap that I love. I take one strap to most gigs, and that strap is broken several times. About to get new extensions on the end of it. If you do not have an extra strap in your gig bag, you are asking for trouble. You are inviting disaster into your life if you don't have a spare strap. So even if you don't use this as your primary strap, it's something to have on your guitar. And if, you know, all goes wrong, you go, no worries, I've got a spare strap in the form of my String Sling. But it is really cool as your primary strap too, holds the guitar neatly in place, functions exactly as you would expect. A guitar strap too. Now, we're gonna put this guitar away because we're gonna be doing the red PRS today because there's lots of love in the red PRS. But to put the guitar away, I'm just gonna pop this open and we're gonna set, there we go. We'll set our String Sling back on a guitar's neck. There's also a convenient little pocket. I have this out for demonstration purposes, but a convenient little pocket up here for tucking the strap extension away. So it's not gonna get in the way of your guitar while it's being stored. It's also not going to bash off your guitar's headstock. That's nice and protected. We're going to pop this back over here. Let me pop my thing on mute. Bit of that. There we go. String Sling, folks. That's going to stay here for the duration of the stream. I may grab it a bit later on. So anyway, that's our String Sling. That's the sponsor for today's stream. It's a lot of fun. It's a very cool little product. Links down below to let you know where you can go get it if you want one, because you do want one. I want one. I've got one right here, and I've got a red one to match my red guitar, but I didn't think you'd see it if I put it on this guitar. Anyway, let's check in with the stream and see how everybody's getting on, and then we'll get into the meat of today's session. We're going to start with a hello from PJ. PJ is the first one in the house. Says, happy Monday, everyone. Happy Monday to you too, PJ. Response Audio is in the house, always with the good insights. Hopefully we're going to have some cool stuff from you today and for you today. Marcine is in the house. Daryl Queen is wishing everybody a happy Earth Day. Happy Earth Day to you too. Looking forward to today's session. My tapping feels dated and trite. Well, tapping can feel dated and trite if you do it in a manner that is going to sound like an obvious thing to say, but in a manner that is dated and trite. And what we mean by that is the eruption lick. Now, for a lot of folks, this is where tapping kind of starts and stops. People do the eruption thing and they go, that's, you know, this kind of lick that we've played 1,000 times. Everybody's heard it 1,000,000 times. That lick is permitted under 2 circumstances. It's permitted when you're playing a Van Halen song, and it's permitted when you are Edward Van Halen. Under no other circumstances is that lick permitted. So I'm not suggesting that that's your tapping style, Daryl. I'm sure yours is much more sophisticated than that. But hey, we're going to give you some cool stuff that you can use today. Who else do we have in the house? Marcine is saying, been working with Andy James' tapping and arpeggios tutorial lately, so this is perfect timing. Fantastic. If you're wondering what we're talking about here, these are some of the lessons that are available on licklibrary.com. If you want lessons, you can go right here. LickLibrary.com, go get yourself some lessons. Kim is in the house. Kim, it's great to see you. Totally agree. Andy's playing is, in fact, ridiculously good. Nice guy, too. Marcine says, learning from the best. And we're talking, oh, yeah, we've got some discussion about the new 4K versions of all the old LickLibrary lessons. We're in the process of upscaling everything to 4K. So if you want to see the old LickLibrary lessons that you guys have learned from over the years, but in the highest human quality, obviously they've always been shot in the highest quality that was available, but, you know, technology moves on. If you want to see them in 4K goodness, they're going to be available very soon. Keep your eyes on your subscription. Mark Crandall's in the house, says, hey, Nick, bought a Danny Gill tapping DVD, but never seriously watched it. This should be good. I think it's going to be a lot of fun. Danny's got some really cool insights into the tapping thing. Danny was, of course, a student of Joe Satriani, who invented, pioneered, I don't know, popularized a lot of the tapping techniques that we use in modern rock guitar today. So Danny's got some really cool stuff to say about tapping, and we're going to be touching on some of that today too. Kate Strange in the house. Kate, it is lovely to see you. Helmet Strap is here, saying, not sure this is one for me as an old classic slash southern rock player, willing to try and learn something new though. Hopefully, there's going to be something for players of every style today. So we'll get to that. Deadman Doogie Van Doogieson is in the house, saying happy Earth Day. Lovely to see you. Cowcat's here. Cranky Tom's here. Nick Harrison is here. Block 18's here. Sacred Godslayer is here. Rock Today is in the house with a lovely Les Paul in his profile picture. John Mack is here. Who else do we have? Mark McNish is in the house. Lovely to see you, Mark. Good to have you on board. Our friend Mika is in the house. Who else? Marty Mooney is tuning in from Alabama. Marty, lovely to see you. My pal Tony's watching on Facebook. Eugene is tuning in from Russia. Eugene, lovely to have you. Who else do we have? Tony B is in the house. Lick Library is awesome. Can confirm. Playing the Lick Library Red PRS today. Here's a good one. Entertamed says, hey Nick, big fan. Oh, thanks man, I appreciate that. Very kind of you. What do you have for suggestions for compression when tapping slash legato? Well, we're going to start that up, my man, because we'll be answering our questions a little bit later on. So stay tuned. We're going to be answering that question as we go. So let's get into it. We're going to begin with a brief discussion of terms. So we all know that we're batting from the same bat? I don't know, mixed metaphors. But we're going to make sure we're reading from the same hymn sheet here. So what is tapping? What is tapping not? Well, this does actually bear exploring, because a lot of folks have the wrong idea about what tapping is because of its name. I feel like the name is more of a descriptor of what it looks like than a descriptor of what it actually is. In the same way that legato technique that we refer to as hammer-ons and pull-offs is not so much a descriptor of how it sounds in modern guitar, let's say. Now, we can play legato that is not legato sounding. We can also pick in a way that is legato. So this is just another reason why the guitar's terms are often very confusing. It's one of those, but we're going to get into it today. So in tapping, in a nutshell, is what happens when we play hammer-ons and pull-offs with the hand that we normally pick with. Now, I'm going to be using the term right hand and left hand here because I'm right-handed. I play right-handed. If you're a left-handed guitar player, obviously you'll reverse those in your brain, but you get the idea. So let's start with a little bit of an exercise. We're going to throw our backing track on. Our backing track is the 80s training montage backing track, which I thought was appropriate for our 80s tapping extravaganza. And let's try doing some hammer-ons. I'm going to start by showing you a very cool hammer-on sequence that you can use to your heart's content. We're in the key of D minor here, so we're going to be using D minor pentatonic for the most part for this next little exercise. But grab your guitars, you're going to want to play along with this. So we're going to start with the large shape in our pentatonic shape, which is this guy here, which is fret number 10 and fret number 13 on our B string. We're going to begin by doing some trills. Trills being repeated hammer-ons and pull-offs. In this case, with our first and our third finger. Let's throw the track on. We'll do some of those together. Nice and easy, right? Track's a little loud in my monitor, so I'm just going to turn it down so it's not super, super loud and isn't bleeding too badly into my microphone. Let's start here. Let's try playing some trills that run like this. What am I doing there? I'm hammering onto fret 13, pulling off to fret number 10. Let's play along together. Out again. Keep going. I'll go here. You keep playing the same thing. By the way, on this 80s backing track, there is the sound of a weight stack slamming. And I'm going to show you this, right? A weight stack slamming. Check it out. You'll hear it in a second. Where is it? There it is. And that is that weight stack. That is the sound of a cable stack slamming. That's taken directly from Owen Hart's 80s and 90s theme tune, which I couldn't not, right? So yeah, it's literally a sample from that theme tune. Please don't sue us, WWE. Anyway, so we've got trills on the go. What we're gonna do now that we have our trills, we're gonna go back to that real quick after I showed you the weight stack thing. I am a meathead after all. Let's do the same thing, but this time what we're gonna do, instead of trilling with our third finger, we're going to keep our first finger posted, and we're going to try doing some hammer-ons and pull-offs with either, this is your choice, either your middle finger or your index finger from your right hand. Again on fret number 13, pulling off to fret number 10. We're in the key of D minor. I'll do middle finger, and I'm going to go with this. I'm going to go. Let's try it together. Now what we're looking for here are distinct hammer-ons and pull-offs. What we're not doing is just tapping our finger onto the string. We're not just slamming the finger on the string, we're doing a distinct hammer-on and a distinct pull-off. This is step number one in getting this working for you. Let me know in the comments if that's working. If that's something you can do, if you can do the hammer-ons and pull-offs with your tapping finger of choice, whichever one it happens to be, we are good to go. If not, take a quick second and get that sus. Now, the next thing we're going to do is we're going to start to incorporate some other notes from our left hand here. And I'm going to show you a really cool lick that is just a fun one to use that is appropriate for blues and classic rock settings. It can be played with hammer-ons and pull-offs like this. Marcin with the hashtag brush, for sure, man. We'll talk about the two types of hammer and two types of pull-offs in a second. Hashtag brush off. We'll get to that in a second. So that's for anybody who's not familiar with our terminology here. We use a specific kind of terminology to describe pull-offs, and there are two kinds. There is a pluck and there is a brush. I'll explore those in a moment. But we'll do this lick together. Now, this lick is a lot of fun. And what we'll do here is we're going to start with our second finger on fret number 10, where we had it previously. It wasn't first finger anymore. We're going to go to our second finger. Our first finger is going to be behind on fret number 9. And what we'll do is we'll play this. We're going to play tap, pull off, tap, pull off. And then pull off to our first finger, hammer back on. A very fun lick. Now, if you only get that far, you've still got something cool that you can play with. We're gonna start with that along with our backing track. And we're gonna play. Should be feeling pretty good. Let's go a little faster. Let's try going. However fast you can get it, however fast you can get it, that's how fast we go. Now this is a fun leg because it's a little like a harmonica in terms of the way it sounds. What we're going to do next, just to make this a bit of a laugh, is we're going to advance this down one fret at a time with both hands. If this is a little bit full on, don't worry about it. It's just a fun lick in case you guys wanted a fun lick to play with. Advancing it down one fret at a time. Loads of fun. Now, there's a fun lick, but if we've lost you off so far, don't worry, we're going back. We're going back on ourselves. But it's a fun little lick in case anybody wants an instant win there. So, we've established what tapping is. We've established that it's a series of hammer-ons and pull-offs, but done with this hand instead of with this hand. Now, on to the next few questions, which is, what do we do with a drunken sailor? What do we do in terms of which fingers we use? What do we do in terms of which directions we hammer on a pull-off? Do we pull up? Do we pull up down? Do we hammer on in this direction, in this direction, in this direction, in this direction? You tell me. Well, I'm about to. So, let's get into the meat of things. In terms of the finger you use, Response Audio says, almost like a tapped blues turnaround when it descends that way. That's basically what I'm looking for here, man. It's the equivalent of this. But in the key of A, it would be. Loads of fun 80s hot rodded blues stuff to be had there. It's very Back to the Future in a way that really appeals to me. So yeah, definitely got that in mind. I actually use this in a solo in the Blitzkrieg set. I don't play it with tapping, I play it with just my left hand, but it's a fun tapping lick anyway. I play with my left hand because I can pose and I can point when I'm doing it. And pointing is a very important part of heavy metal. So this song is in the key B and it has this dive whammy bar thing that was with a whammy bar dive. None of my guitars have whammy bars. So the solo is and then on it goes into more silliness. But that little lick there, we can ignore that bit, that's coming next. That's another thing, but I use that lick all the time. It's a really fun way to get that sort of diving whammy bar effect or that blues turnaround thing. Anyway, on to the mechanics of tapping and how it works. So let's get back into the close-up cam so we can see what's going on here. In terms of our mechanics, what we are looking for with our tapping finger is whichever finger you use is fine. Doesn't really matter which one. Successfully used, lots of folks, I'll say that again, easy for me to say. Lots of folks have successfully developed tapping styles using their index finger. Lots of folks have successfully developed tapping styles using their middle finger. Doesn't really matter. I'm gonna encourage you to use as many fingers as you possibly can. Don't be afraid to experiment with other fingers too, or several groupings of fingers if you want. We'll get onto that in a bit. But what we're looking for in terms of hammer-ons is exactly the same qualities that we're looking for with a left-hand hammer-on, i.e. we are looking for the finger to strike the string, yes, strike the string, in such a way that it forcefully impacts with the fret. Forcefully impacts with the fret. You slam your finger on so that it's forcefully impactful on the fret. It is not the sound of your finger hitting the string that makes the sound. It is the sound of the string hitting the fret. I'll say that again. The finger hitting the string doesn't make the sound. The string hitting the fret makes the sound. Once we've done that, we just need to hold it there for the duration that we are going to use a hammer-on for, or well, duration we want a note to ring out for. So if we play a hammer-on like this, we would never stop that short just because it's hammer-on. We know that we can hammer-on and hold our notes in place. With our taps, we can do the same. We can play, for example, we can hold it in place for as long as we want, just like as if we were fretting another note. Dead easy. So once again, a forceful strike that causes the string to impact with the fret, and that's what makes the sound. Once we're there, we can hold it there in a relaxed fashion. Don't press down so hard that the note goes sharp, like this. Ugh. Don't want that. Hard enough and fast enough that it strikes the fret, and no harder. Now, in terms of the pull-off, we have two ways we can do this. We can pull off upwards, we can pull off downwards. I don't think it makes a difference. I think it's a question of whatever feels more comfortable. Myself, I have licks where I'll pull off downwards, I have licks where I'll pull off upwards. It just varies. But what we're looking for here is we are looking for the pull-off to be a friction brush. A friction brush. Let me explain what's going on there. It's not the sort of thing you use to brush cat hair off your clothes. What it is we use the friction of the calluses on our fingers. If you don't have calluses on this finger yet, you will develop it the more you do this stuff. We use the friction of the callus to brush the string. If you do this very quickly, just take your right hand finger and just brush the strings over here. You'll see what I mean. It makes quite a loud noise. Excuse the hum, we've got a lot of game going on here because we're tapping. That makes a lot of noise. We're not plucking the strings, I'm not doing this. Just brushing over them. That's what this should feel like. It should feel like a friction style brush. We can grab the string and pluck it for a special effect if we want to, which sometimes we'll do with the Van Halen type thing. But that's very much more of a special effect. When we really want the string to meow, for the most part, it's a brush style pull off. If you didn't know what this was all about, by the way, this is also the way to get fluid left hand legato, is to play using a brush style of pull off rather than a plucking style of pull off. The pluck is cool, sounds very loud, but it's also quite fatiguing, very hard to maintain. If you ever find yourself running out of stamina with pull offs, that could be why. Maybe you're plucking when you should be brushing. Anyway, that's another story for another day. So we strike the string, we brush. Easy, piece of cake. That is the mechanics of tapping in a nutshell, friends. Let's do some licks that we can play together. Now, our most obvious licks that we can start to play are some licks that are derived from our pentatonic scale. I'm gonna show you some of these today. These are some fun licks that you can get your teeth into when it comes to the tapping thing. And the way we're gonna get this is we are going to play two pentatonic scales all at once. We're gonna start by playing D minor pentatonic using just our left hand. Let's go like this. So left hand's the only fingers in the string. Let's go again. D minor pentatonic, box number one. Obviously you can play this anywhere you can find notes that sound good on the guitar. It's just an easy place for most folks to play. Fret numbers are 13, 10, 12, 10 times 3, 13, 10 again, 13, 10, 12, 10, 13, 10. Dead easy. Let's do it again, but this time what we're gonna do is we're gonna use our first finger from our left hand and our tapping finger of choice from our right hand. Let's go like this. Hopefully that makes sense. Piece of cake, right? Now at this point you might be going, why on earth would I ever do that if I can do this? Well, first of all, it's fun, but secondly, it frees up your left hand to do some other stuff. So we've got this. Let's take what was our first finger and make it our third finger. And what we'll do here is our trills again. Ambulance style trills, piece of cake. Notice my first finger is ready to grab it in the notes. I'm gonna grab fret number 8 on my E string. And the way we'll get this is we'll tap, pull off the first finger and hammer back on. Loads of fun. You can play this with any phrasing, any rhythm that you want, anything you normally play with your left hand, you can play with your tapping type stuff. It can sound thoroughly bluesy in a way that you might not expect. So that. Doesn't sound like your typical shreddy tapping thing to me. It sounds kind of phrasey and kind of fun. It's got a bit of harmonica about it, a bit of all sorts of other instruments about it, but it also has that 80s charm that we love. Let's move this same thing up one string without changing anything. Now, our friend Mike has tuned in, and he's mentioned a very important part of this, which is these string-to-string transitions, which we'll get to in a second. So far, we've had these two licks, which sound pretty cool. These are some pentatonic licks. What about if we were to go to our next part of the pentatonic scale, where there's 12, there's 10, here, we're gonna go to fret number 7. Why 7? It's part of the next pentatonic box. So let's do 12, 10, 7. Oh, we're laughing, dead easy. Same thing up one string. 12, 10, 7. So far we've got this. If you do this and nothing else, you've got a little bit of tapping under your fingers, a bit of tapping vocabulary. But what you might be thinking here, let me know in the comments, by the way, if you guys are playing this stuff and it feels good to you, if it's working and it's feeling good, let me know in the comments. I would love to know for sure, to make sure that we're battening up the right alley here, so to speak. Mixing my metaphors terribly today. Here's a cool one from a friend, DC7IFY. I hope I'm saying that right. It says, finally a good explanation. So you're staying within the pentatonic scale like box 5 and box 1 first finger tapping. For sure, that's exactly what we're doing here. So we're taking the, we're taking two pentatonic boxes and overlaying them across each other. So you might think about the first finger notes on box 1, which are the third finger notes or higher notes on box number 5, as being like where two jigsaw pieces join in the puzzle. So we've got jigsaw puzzle, where the two pieces join, the two puzzle pieces join, and that's where it is. So we're playing these two. This is just one way of looking at this, by the way. But for this particular pentatonic thing, that's basically what we're doing. And you can do this with any pair of pentatonic boxes that you like. You don't have to be next to each other either, just throwing that out there. So we could play, if we've done box 1 and box 5, we could put box 1 in our left hand and tap box number 2 in this hand, for example. Or we could go all the way up to box 3 and tap the highest notes from box 3. And have loads of fun doing that. So that's just a way of kind of doing this. Here's a fun one from Sacred Godslayer. As if you guys can visualize easily, I suggest skipping one pentatonic box. Well, haven't we just said that? There we go. Bigger interval, more showy effect. He's absolutely right, and we're gonna get to that in a little second. So that's one way of doing this. But within this little lick, we've got lots of little variations that we can do. Lots of variations that we can do, depending upon what goes on with our tapping hand. But one thing that I wanna talk about, which is a sticking point for a lot of folks, is how we get from one string to another string. How do we get from one string to another string? So we have this lick. How do we get from this string to this string in a graceful fashion? Well, what we do, as our friend Mike rightly pointed out, is we reach for a technique called the hammer-on from nowhere, which I would say, just personally, I think it's, I know what we all mean when we say this, but to me, that's a term that is like, it's an interesting one, actually. It's like string skipping. This is one of Nick Harrison's observations that just struck me, and I went, oh yeah, it's a good point. Which is like, why is string skipping even a thing? Like, why is that something that we think about? Are we duty bound to play on adjacent strings until we do something special? And I'm like, oh yeah, that's really true. That's really strange. Why is that even a thing? For me, hammer-ons from nowhere, don't know why they're a thing, because it implies that a hammer-on has to be from somewhere. But I know exactly what we're talking about here. Anyway, so what is a hammer-on from nowhere? After I've just said it's a term that shouldn't exist. What is a hammer-on from nowhere? Well, it's basically the same as a tap. When we tap, we strike our finger onto the string in such a way that the string impacts the fret. We can do the same thing with our left hand. If we have no notes going on here, we play as if we're playing a tap, but we can play it with one of the fingers from this hand. I like my third finger in this lick. As a transition finger. That's a nice, easy way to get from one string to another. And on it goes. Here, that's a nice transition finger. I'm going to highlight this very quickly, by the way. This is one from Nick Harrison saying a really cool Ron Thal effect is to play a standard pentatonic box in the left hand and then tap out what will be passing tones an octave higher. For sure, totally agree. Now, a fun way to do this, this is a way to get from Nuno Betancourt to Ron Thal to Sean Lane in two frets. What you get if you play just the standard pentatonic box with this hand. If you play the same pentatonic box, or the same type of box that you'd be playing with this hand, let's say we're playing D. If we play the appropriate box, it's Nuno. If you play one fret higher than it should be, it's Buckethead or Bumblefoot. If you play two frets higher than it should be, it's Sean Lane. One, Nuno, Buckethead, Bumblefoot, Sean Lane. There you go. A very red beach as well, for sure. Another great tapper. There's much talk of Steve Lynch here as well. The other 80s Lynch. Great guitar player. Wonderful stuff. We'll get into that. So anyway, our transition fingers. We use hammer-ons from nowhere to transition. Here's how we're going to practice it. We're going to throw our backing track on. What we're going to do is we're going to play our first lick here. Our objective is to play fret number 10 with our third finger on the B string and hold it there. Let's go again. Wherever it feels comfortable. Once we have that, we can then take our tapping to wherever we want it to go. Maybe not there yet, but we'll get there. Now, that's transitions from string to string. We use hammer-ons from nowhere to get from string to string, or we can just tap to get from string to string. That's easy too, nice piece of cake, right? So let's move on to some things that we can do with the tapping sequence that we already have. So we have a tapping sequence. Let's talk about some cool effects that we can use some rhythm for, we can use some duplicated notes for, we can use some slides and some other stuff for to make this pop without getting any extra information in there. So if we play the same tapping loop that we just had, don't know how it ends up there. That's fine, but we can spice this up by including not one tap, but two taps before we do our hammer-ons and pull-ups. Like this. Oh, my main camera is misbehaving. It did this the other week. I'm gonna switch the main cam off. We don't need it right now. We'll just give it a second to rest. Let's just leave that be. If we play some two tapping phrases, let's just get rid of that. Do some two tapping phrases. What we can do is we can play tap, pull off, and then our hammer and pull off sequence with our left hand. So we can get this. Now we can alternate that between our single tap and our double tap. So we might get this. Now that already spices things up. That already makes things look more interesting. But what if we were to play with the idea of introducing rhythms that aren't always the same? It's not always the same rhythm. So what I mean by that is instead of playing this all the time, what if we just randomly stop on some of the notes? Well, that can sound really fun too, and that spices things up yet again. It breaks up that pattern type sound that we had, makes it a little bit more flowing, a bit more interesting. So we might get this. Already that's more interesting. Now, what do we do on those pauses becomes the question. What do we do in the pauses? Well, if we're pausing on a left-hand fretted note, we give it some vibrato because it sounds nice. So we could play this. Is there any reason why we shouldn't do it with our tapping hand? Nope, absolutely not. Let's do some tapping vibrato. Now, this is one of the things that I think really starts to set this thing on fire when you start to apply a little bit of vibrato with the tap notes, because they have this really cool sound, this really cool fluty thing going on that I'm really into. Now, what I might do is when I play with my tap, you could do the vibrato with your left hand, like this, with your right hand rather, like this. It's a bit clumsy and never feels quite so good as the other way we're gonna do it, which is this. So we do it with the right hand. Ugh, terrible. Not nice. Gross, doesn't sound very good. But if we hold the tap and apply a bit of left hand vibrato, it can sound really freaking cool. Now, what I'm trying to do here, this is the way I think about this, is I'll tap and I'll pin the string in place. So it's almost like I'm trying not to move it with this hand, trying to hold it in place and apply the bend behind the note. If you pay attention very quickly, I want you to pay attention to this B string, but I want you to pay attention to it this side of my hand. Watch this. Watch how it doesn't move on this side of the hand. Watch the B string very closely. Notice that B string. The G string moves because I'm moving out the way with the vibrato. The B string is not moving like this. I'm holding it in place and doing the vibrato with the left hand. Now, this is a really fun thing you can do to break up those rhythms. You can apply a little bit of vibrato with the tap, and it sounds very cool. Now let's put that in with our other ideas. Oops. All of a sudden that's starting to sound a lot more fluid and a lot more interesting. And all we're doing here is we're breaking up the rhythm by randomly throwing in two taps versus one tap, and also throwing in some vibrato on the tapped notes. Let's see if this camera's gonna behave itself again. I think it's just a bit too hot. I think it's getting warm and it doesn't like it, I think. Either that or the HDMI cable is on the way out, who knows. But it's behaving itself for now, so let's go back to this shot of my face. Hello, hey, we're back again. So that's one thing we can do, but now that we've been doing this tapped vibrato thing, what we can also start to do is we can start to throw in some bends. Now, much like a tapped vibrato, where we pin the string in place and apply the bending motion with our left hand on this side of the string, we can do the same with some bends. Now, what I'll do here is I might tap to our 13th fret again, 13th fret once again, same deal, 13th fret, And then by pinning it in place, I can bend that note up to the pitch of fret number 15. So we might get this. Now, what you do with this is limited only by your creativity, right? You can do all manner of stuff with this. You can tap and you can bend. You can tap and rebend and do the Gilmore thing. You can pull off at the apex of the bend, so it goes up, down, like this. Ooh. It's really only limited by how creative you want to get with this. There are no limits on what you can do here. If it sounds good, it is good. Say regards, Slayer, with a shout out for Vito Bratta, who did loads of this stuff in his pomp, and I assume still does. Yeah, man, there's loads of creativity to be had here. So if we throw some bends in with our tapping pattern, beauty of this is it's gonna work with two fret bends in most places here. Here's another one where you can tap while bending, Randy Rhoads style. Sure, we get to that for sure. Let's get to that, but we're in our, that's the weight stack. We might get this. Loads of fun to be had there. Loads and loads of fun. Again, just limited by your creativity here. Bending, vibrato, all allowed. Now let's get into some slightly more obtuse stuff, because everything we've done thus far has been on these two pentatonic positions, but there are other pentatonic positions next to it too. We have this box one. Sorry, this box five. This box one. What about this box two? Can we play some stuff from there? Well, yeah, sure we can. So what's box two gonna look like? It's gonna look like, we'll do it by tapping finger, just for argument's sake. We'll get 15, 13, 15, 13, 14, 12, 15, 12, 15, 12, 15, 13. Dead easy. Now, what do we do with this? Well, the most obvious thing to do is to alternate whether we're tapping this note at the top of box one, or this note at the top of box two. Oops. And there, all of a sudden, just by playing between these two boxes, now this sounds way less predictable. For reference, we had this before. Which is cool. But now we have this. Let me get it right. Behave yourself. Once again. I'm lost in Bumblefoot land. Does it have to be pentatonic? Nope, absolutely not. Chris Davis with a very kind comment saying, this stuff is pure gold. Thanks, Nick. I appreciate that, man. Very kind of you. Smooth transition from string to string is the issue. Well, let's get onto that very quickly. We talked about this before, but if you want to get a smooth transition from string to string, hammer-ons from nowhere are your friend. Also, using the underside of your tapping hand, specifically this bit of the palm, to mute the strings that we're not playing. So for example, if we go to these cameras, let me show you what it looks like. If you take a look at this, if I'm tapping on the B string, take a look at where my palm is. Here's the B string. Where's the B string? I shall move it so you can see it. There we go. I'm resting all the way up to the G string with my palm. So it might look like this, for example. So that's going to help with the transitions, these muting things, that's really going to help. Obviously, this hand is dealing with all of the muting this side of the note that we're playing. So if we're playing on the G string, we're muting the left hand, we're muting the B and E string with the left hand. That's kind of probably the easiest way to explain it. So yeah, it's the issue for a lot of folks, so don't feel like you're alone there. Sacred God Slayer is right, the metronome is your friend here, but don't be afraid just to sit on one position and then like stay there until it's time to go and try and jump. A fun thing to do, this is a Guthrie thing, is to focus on just landing the transition note as the last note in the pattern. So if you're having trouble with this transition note, say on the, let's say we were here and the transition note was on the 10th fret on the whatever string it is, B string, and we're having difficulty with that transition, make that the note that you finish on. So there, for example, when I was doing these big licks before, the difficult part was getting the first finger over in time. So when I was practicing those, I would focus on getting my first finger to where it needs to be. And holding that first finger. In situ. Now, this leads me to the next thing, which is we talked about the idea of jumping between notes with our tapping finger. We can jump between notes, but there are other things we can do to go between notes. Let's say if we took the high E string as our example, and the notes we decided we want to jump between were 10 and 8. On the left hand, and then we wanted to play 13 and 15 on the right hand. Well, we could move our tapping finger. We can also slide our tapping finger. We tap and slide, just like we would with our left hand. A lot of people will slide up, but sliding down is very cool too. That's a very Guthrie thing to do. Loads of fun. Slides are a lot of fun, but what about if we decided we wanted to involve another finger? Shakara, what about this finger with the black ring on it right here? Well, can we do that? Yeah. Is it something that's fancy and super advanced and should never be looked at by any guitar player ever who hasn't got their black belt in tapping? Absolutely not. It's the easiest thing in the world. Let me show you a fun application for this. So I do with one of my bands an arrangement of Everybody Wants to Rule the World. Hopefully you guys can hear that clean sound reasonably well. So we'll start with the... Let's just tune the guitar before we play that. I think too many bends have put it very much south of in tune. See if I remember this. It's been a few months since we've gigged. Ba-dum-ba. Now where is the line? Oh yeah. Behave yourself. These strings are a bit too light for that. That's my way of playing that lick. Loads of fun. Now, what we're doing here is I'm using two fingers, this finger, to access different notes. Let me show you how that's going to work in the context of our lovely big gain sound in the key of D minor. To remind you what D minor sounds like in case you'd forgotten. What if we played 8 and 10 in our left hand as usual, but with our right hand we assigned the middle finger or the index finger, whichever one you're happy using, to 13. But we also assigned our ring finger or our middle finger, whichever one you have spare, to fret number 15. Well, we could do all this really fun stuff where we go. I put this so badly out of tune. Let's just retune the guy. I thought I was just fretting too hard, but I've put it really badly out of tune. And there we have tons of fun to be had. This is probably a little beyond the scope of today's session, but let's do a bit of a recap on what we've done today. So what we've done is we've established the mechanics of tapping. Just go back to this real quick. The mechanics of tapping, which are how you do good hammer-ons, how you do good pull-offs. We've established some string we can practice. We've established some stuff for getting from string to string. We've established the way you can visualize different patterns in the pentatonic scale and use that to generate some cool tap licks. Of course, you are free to use other scales too. We've also talked about varying rhythm. We've talked about bends and vibrato. We've talked about sliding. We've talked about accessing other notes at the top end. We've talked about using other fingers, loads of fun stuff. There's fertile ground here, So let's talk about some more philosophical things, some places to take inspiration for your tapping stuff. I really like listening to drummers for tapping stuff. Behave yourself, he said, hitting the cable. I like listening to drummers. If you listen to drum fills, especially really like I won't say the gospel chops thing, but gospel chops. Listen to that sort of stuff, where the drummers are going absolutely crazy, where there's just blurs of notes, but there's a very clear sub-rhythm under there. So it might be like, that's my best attempt to sing something like that, right? You can't sing the individual notes, but you can hear this, For me, I like the idea of using the tap as a rhythmic idea that we can use to intersperse with just some blurs of notes. It doesn't really matter what's going on in terms of the left hand blurs of notes, as long as the tap is playing something rhythmically interesting or rhythmically cogent or even just something that you can, you know, wrap your head around, we're good. So, what might that look like? Well, it might look like this. If I open up some scalar ideas, I might get something like this. Loads and loads and loads of fun, right? That is just me thinking about a rhythm with the right hand and letting the left hand fill in some notes. Now, obviously, that took a bit of practice to get to there, but that's not a series of licks. It's maybe a series of little musical phonemes that I've put together, but it's not a lick. I couldn't tap it out for you. I just made it up because the more I've spent doing this, the more I'm able to just do that stuff. So that's an interesting philosophical point. We've got some questions coming in. And we're going to be answering the questions. But before we do, I want to take a quick second to remind you about today's sponsors. In case you missed it, today's lesson has been brought to you by the String Sling, which is a string protector and also strap. You saw me play that in the intro. If you missed that, go back and watch the intro after this stream is done, right? I'm going to show you how that works. Essentially what this is it's a device for protecting your guitar strings, but it also doubles as a guitar strap. It's very cool bit of kit. Links down below. Also, this lesson was brought to you by Guitar Interactive Magazine. You can go here, Guitar Interactive Magazine, to go and get loads of reviews and interviews and gear news, all the guitar related stuff that isn't lesson oriented. For your lessons, go to licklibrary.com and specifically go check this one out. This is Sam Bell's Contemporary Tapping Arpeggios. Now what this is a lesson by War Sam on all things tapping related. It goes from pretty bare bones stuff like we've done today, but it's a really good place to go after this stream if you want to use the stream as a leaping off point and get into some more advanced stuff. Go check that out. There's a link in the description. That is Sam Bell's Contemporary Tapping Arpeggios. That's available as part of your Lick Library membership. Go get it. It's loads of fun. Sam's great at this stuff. But we are going to move on and we're going to answer some of your questions. Hey, mistimed the click because I was trying to do everything with one hand and realized you can't click your fingers and click a mouse at the same time. Never mind. Who knows? So, some questions. Here we go. So, Chris Davies is asking the question. How low should the action be? Well, that sort of depends. Depends on preference. For me, I like my action fairly low, but I like my action fairly low on all of my guitars. I'm more of a big strings, low action kind of guy. So my little holy trinity of things I like in a guitar are reasonably heavy strings, so I can keep them in tune. And by reasonably heavy, I don't mean like super heavy. I mean like 10s, 11s. We're not talking like 13s or something like that. So generally speaking, 10s and up, depending on the guitar's scale length, with a low action and a high, tall fret. I like a tall fret so I can get underneath it and bend, but I like the action low and the string fairly tight. So reasonably high string tension, low action, and a tall fret height. That makes me a happy Nick. But really, you can tap on any setup with any action. It doesn't really make a difference, I don't think. As long as you can get a convincing strike onto the string, you're good. If you feel like when you're trying to strike the string, you end up with this elastic band type effect where you're having to press through the string like this, and it's just like pressing through treacle, you're not going to get that quick strike of the string on the fret that makes a tap work. Same with a hammer-on, to be honest. Unless you can get that strike through, you're good. You're probably in trouble. So if you can get the strike through and you can move quickly onto the string, we're good. Same is true for tapping. Can you do this? Not without a string damper, but we'll get to that. Now, here's a question from Sacred God Slayer. It's not really a question. It says, I find it interesting how much you angle the right hand when you tap with multiple fingers. I am much more parallel to the fretboard. I think what he's referring to is this. Now, that is something that really works very well. This parallel to the fingers thing works really well if you tap with multiple fingers and you have some device for dampening the strings. But for me, I find this slightly more parallel approach. It just works a little better in the heat of battle. Muting. So that's what I'm trying to say. I'm reading comments at the same time. So for me, if I take this sort of approach where I'm very up over the strings, that can work really great, but I lose my ability to mute the lower strings. Whereas here, I'm sacrificing a little bit of tapping dexterity for a slightly more efficient muting technique. So, let me go back to these cameras to show you. This is the reason. If you look at the I can't speak and play at the same time. If you look at the right hand palm, with this parallel technique, I can get my string muting still working, whereas I can't do it with this, because look how far my palm is away from where I go. There I'd have to dedicate like my first finger to muting. If I do some really silly stuff, like one of the licks in 51 over the top rock licks, I'll sometimes be able to do this. not super clean, but you get the idea, or super reliable. That means this hand has to work harder to do the muting. So it's just one of those things. It's a very much a your mileage may vary thing. Really cool question, a really cool comment. Now, here's another one from SK Script. How can I make a long sequence of tapping all over the neck, just like you did while you were talking about drum fills? Well, here's what you do. The long sequence is made up of a series of short sequences, and the more short sequences you have in your vocabulary, the better. So what I'm doing here is I'm taking little parts of the fretboard that I know that I can tap with. For example, we're in D minor. I know that this top end of this three note string scale shape with these notes slung on top works for me. I've explored that in free time improv. Now, what I'd do with this is I would encourage you to throw backing track on. We're gonna stick with this 80s backing track, because it's been the theme of the day. And I'd encourage you to set a tempo boundary for this. So maybe you play bop, 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 or even slower. Maybe play quarter notes. And we play some of this. What we're looking for here is just ways to get around the neck. Oops. And what we're not worrying about here is memorizing a bunch of patterns. We're just finding our way around and learning to navigate by feel and by instinct. Through that process, with enough time dedicated to it, and I don't mean years, I mean weeks, months, you will very quickly develop a little, I guess, a little collection of things that feel comfortable and are easy to string together in the way that we mentioned when we talked about the drum fill thing. So here's another one from Cowcat saying, question, how the high registers and low strings are treated by the greatists? I feel it's very ugly sound besides intonation. Yeah, you know what it is? As far as the high notes on the low strings, this is one of the arguments for why you should learn different stuff in different positions, because like, this note here, if we take, say for example, this D note, if I play a D note here, it sounds pretty cool. If I play this, that's a good sounding D note. If I play it here, it sounds wildly different to here. Ugh. Better. Still good. Good. A little thin. Haven't got a D note there. Something I heard Eric Johnson was like raked over the coals for by Exam Magazine. Not us. Definitely not us. Just throwing that out there. It was, you know, pre-GI, I think. And it was like 90s sort of thing. And they gave him some hard times for playing licks in ideas. Playing licks in places that weren't obvious. So he would play, you know, certain things in certain places and move his fretting hand around in ways that weren't necessarily the easiest to reach. The reason for this is because they all sound different. And that's what he said. He's like, well, it sounds different in different positions. And they went, what a silly and pretentious thing to say. And I'm going, no, he's absolutely right. It sounds different in different positions. So in terms of this, generally speaking, in the high registers and the low strings, we kind of avoid them. personally, I just don't really play them. If that makes so anything, for me, there's a little invisible diagonal line that starts about 15th fret on the low E string and works its way diagonally across to the highest fret on the high E string. See that little diagonal line? And it's almost like this part of the fretboard is a no-go zone. This little line here, I'll divide it with my thumb so you can see, that is almost like a do not play, like here be dragons. It's not that I can't play there, but it's that there are much more convenient and much better sounding places to get these notes. These notes up here. Would sound much better if we played them. What were we playing there? Sound much better played. Right here, or anywhere else. So generally speaking, we just don't bother. Now, here's a question that I promised I would answer earlier on here. So this is one from our friend Entertamed. Says, hey Nick, big fan. That is really good of you to say, by the way, I appreciate that. Says, question, do you have any suggestions for compression when tapping? Sure, so personally, I like a reasonable amount of gain is always helpful. The right pickup really helps. These pickups are great for this sort of stuff. What you can do, which is quite fun, is you can have an overdrive pedal set not as a compressor and not really as an extra gain device, but as an EQ shaper. A bit like folks will do for boosting a metal tone, for example. Now right here, what I've got is I've got an Ibanez Tube Screamer, one of the cheap ones. It's like a little mini guy. I think it's the cheap one they've got, TS Mini. What we can do is we can take this in a clean tone to the delay off. If I throw my Tube Screamer on, it's not adding a lot. There I have the gain on zero, but I haven't dimed the level. I've kept the level at a unity level. So it's the same level when I turn the pedal on. It's not acting as a boost because I already have enough gain out of the amp. What it's doing is it's shaving a bit of top end off. It's adding a little bit of compression in the mids, I guess. That's with it on, with it off. Very subtle, but if I throw it on top of a drive sound, that's with it on, let's turn it off. With it on, you almost don't notice the difference, but it feels very different. So, that's with it off. Just reveals the differences between the notes a little bit more starkly. Whereas that just kind of irons them out. You can still hear the differences between the notes. So if I'm striking the notes in different ways to get the EVH phaser thing. Just makes everything a little more even. So a little bit of overdrive, not adding any gain per se, but just friendlying up the front end can really help with that stuff. Also a fun thing we can do, this is something that I've done here, is I've got a model of an 1176 compressor. Funnily enough, I have it between my amp and my cab. So I'm using the Super Kraken, we're going to a Boss tube amp expander. We've got a model of the 1176 in there, which is really fun. If I turn it off, it's not really adding a lot because the amp is already very compressed. That's with it off. Turn it on. It doesn't really add any perceptive gain or particularly change the feel. But what it does is it seems to take whichever frequency is the most pronounced on any given note and just smush that down. So if a note is particularly toppy, bass the top end down. If the notes are particularly boomy, bats the boomy part down, if that makes sense. Obviously, I know that's not what it's doing, but that's certainly what it feels like to me. So it seems to even the tone out a little bit without really drastically changing the tone. That comes after the amp. I wouldn't run that in front of the amp because what I want, I have a compressor pedal here, which I can throw on. What I don't want is I don't want the notes to be super dynamically even. That's the compressor in front of the amp. That to me is evening out the notes too much on the way in, so they lose a lot of the character. It becomes exceptionally easy to play, but I don't necessarily want that. What I want is I want the help from an overdrive. It's a little bit more work. But that's giving me a little bit of extra help in terms of the playing, but it's not killing the character of the notes. Each note has its own unique character, which comes from the dynamic interacting with the overdrive pedal, interacting with the amp, etc., etc., etc. The compressor kind of kills that, whereas the overdrive preserves it to an extent, if that makes sense. So that's a lot of stuff on compression and stuff. Maybe we'll do a thing on pedals and gain staging one day, because that could be quite a lot of fun. I'll have to figure out a way to get the camera on my pedals, but I'll figure that out. That's a me problem, but I'll suss that. Here's one last one from our friend, because we've run over here, but it's fun, so who cares? From CSN Audio, says, do you have any tips for creating rhythmically interesting two-finger tapping licks? Certainly do. Take inspiration, again, from drummers. Pay attention to drummers who maybe do that classic Mike Portnoy thing, where they play hand, 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 foot, foot. You get the idea, right? Listen to some drum fills like that and try using your tapping fingers either like the right and left hand or just like the right hand. So, for example, what we might get if we take the inspiration from that lick where we play hand, foot, sorry, right, left, foot, foot. We might get a tapping lick that might run like this. Quite hard to do, but it's loads of fun. That's quite good fun. What I might do is I might do the same thing. Or a similar sort of thing across multiple strings. That can work really well. Ooh, there we go, loads of fun. Tons of fun to be had there. I think the thing with this as well is I'm saying take inspiration from drummers. What I don't mean is copy them. What I don't mean is be slavish about, like, I must play exactly what the drummer has played. It's more a question of just take inspiration from that approach and see what comes out. And as with all of these things, follow the stuff that sounds cool. So if it sounds cool, even if it wasn't what you originally intended, if it sounds cool, it's cool. Anyway, guys, we've run 15 minutes over time. What else is new? We do this every Monday. In case you're watching for the first time, we do this every Monday. It's live on the Lick Library and Guitar Interactive YouTube channels. Go give us a subscribe on whichever channel you happen to be watching on, and whichever channel you don't happen to be watching on, give us a subscribe there too. It lets us let you know when we're about to go live. Don't forget, this lesson was brought to you by Lick Library and Guitar Interactive Magazine, and it's also brought to you by our friends at The String Sling, providing protection for your guitar, which also doubles as a strap. It has accessory pouches in it. I'm gonna play out on the Maybach and show you what this looks like. So once again, in case you were wondering, dear friends, String Sling looks like this. Take it off the guitar. Let's show you how quickly we can do this. Take it off the guitar. There we go. That is my strings covered. I'm gonna pop the strap attachment out from here. You can take this off, by the way. If you don't want to use the strap attachment, you can just use it as literally a neck protector, but I'm gonna throw this over my shoulder. Now I have a strap. Dead easy, piece of cake, really, really good. Make sure you hide the Velcro if you have long hair because it will get stuck, but that's fine. It's nice Velcro, it's not sharp or any of that stuff. It's actually really, really nice materials. Very comfy, slightly elasticated strap. We love a bit of that. I think I've put it on a little too far on this end, so let me do a quick adjustment. This is something that I'm gonna keep in my gig bag because it protects my strings, but also it means that I've always got a spare strap. It's great fun. Anyway, let's play out in the Maybach. This lesson's brought to you by the String Sling, this cool red attachment. I will see you guys next week. Happy tapping. Let's play out in the 80s track once again. But this time, on a different guitar. Probably should have tuned that one first, but it's a lot of fun. Thanks for having me. My name's Nick Jennison. See you guys next week. Hi, my name's Nick Jennison, and it's my pleasure to announce that GI Plus, the exclusive lesson platform from Guitar Interactive magazine, is moving to LickLibrary.com. GI Plus features a whole host of the best players and educators in the world, bringing you exclusive lessons on everything from metal to blues to fusion and everything in between. Want to level up your shred chops? Check out How to Play Fast by Andy James. Or how about Sweet Picking with Rick Graham? Or maybe country's more your bag? Well, how about a full-length country guitar course from Andy Wood? Interested in learning how to play over changes? Well, members get access to hours of exclusive lessons from fusion maestro Tom Quayle. Or maybe you want your playing to sound more soulful. Well, who better than Chris Buck to show you how it's done? Members also get access to every lesson ever published in Guitar Interactive magazine, including Michael Caswell's legendary Pro Concepts column. Or maybe you want to learn the secrets of the masters. Well, members get access to over 70 full-length tech sessions where our tutors painstakingly decode the styles of players like David Gilmour, Eddie Van Halen, John Petrucci, Larry Carlton, Slash, Tosin Abasi, Paul Gilbert, and many more. And you get all of this in addition to all of the amazing content on LickLibrary.com, which includes note-for-note tuition of over 60 classic albums, weekly lesson uploads, a backing track library, and one-to-one player support. There has never been a better time to sign up than right now.